is what you give is what you get. Hot pants and style, don't let our world go wild. Mama's youngest child is learning fast. Got to get up as soon as you lay down. Don't get nothing from a blessing.
To make the world go round. Afternoon, everybody. I know some of you are messaging me, but I'll have to work on that later. So today, Dr. Radlett is a little under the weather. She caught what her husband had, so hopefully she gets better before long. But I'm in charge, so free day. No. Can't fall behind. So we're going to run through the slides today. Got a lot of videos to cover. We'll talk about Citizens United, so make sure to pay attention when that comes through. And then these are kind of things you need to be paying attention to for the test. Kind of the two primary system, kind of what's entailed in that, and then what Stephen Colbert talks about. So let me pull up our slides today. So get ready to run, and let's roll. Whoop, let's move that out of the way. I can't even see what I'm doing. So. Anyways, okay, so first we're going to talk about the presidential Democratic primaries. This is for the Democratic Party here in the United States. And that the Democrats award delegates proportionally, and there is these votes in every state. And one of the things, and the next slide we'll talk about the Republican primaries, that the primaries are meant to bring about a candidate within the party. If you pay attention to kind of the election cycle, you'll know that you'll have a whole group of Democrats. So kind of in this last election, you had, you know, Joe Biden, Warren, Yang, a lot of these other Democrats, and the Democrats had their primaries to pick one. The one that came out of that was Joe Biden. And then the Republicans also had one. And the one that came out of that was Donald Trump. Now, you may not think there was one in the Republican Party, but there was, because there were some other Republicans, I think two or three others that were out there. So we see some interesting things within the Democratic primaries. And this map up here shows the 2016 primaries. But the Democratic Party specifically has super delegates. And kind of these are some delegates that are not specifically stated to a certain state, but just kind of choose for themselves who to vote for. So they're kind of outside the system. 2020, there was like 775 of these unpledged delegates or super delegates there. So additionally, you can see down here who won each one. 2016 Democratic delegates, Clinton and Sanders. Clinton won. But then with superdelegates, she got a little bit more of a boost. So they add on top of that. And one thing interesting about the Democratic Party here is you'll see caucuses. Has anybody ever participated in a caucus in the class? This is like show and tell time. Anybody? We don't do them in Oklahoma. Anybody on the chat? I can't see the chat. But yeah. Oh, yeah. Who here is from Iowa? That's a good one. We have a PhD student, Erica. She is from Iowa. And really, you get to spend the whole day voting. You get in a room with a whole bunch of people and you vote throughout the day on who you want your preferred candidate to be. We don't have really time to talk about that, SGT on Friday, but I may send out a kind of video on that. It's a really lengthy process, but apparently it's really fun. So hopefully one day we get to do that. But big thing, understand what primaries are. And then we have the Republican primaries throughout the United States. They do not have the superdelegates in this sense. We have 2016 up here on the map, and it kind of shows you who won in each. Let's see. Here was the 2020 results over here. So there was a Weld guy. Just didn't win. But usually the incumbent is the one who wins their primaries because that's who the party wants. So the Republicans award delegates at conventions, proportional vote, hybrid, and a winner-take-all system. You can see Oklahoma here is a hybrid system and that the delegates could go elsewhere depending on how the state votes. And an important thing within the Republican primaries, the rules change from one election to the other. So things can change constantly, throughout the years here. So important thing to remember also here in Oklahoma, if you're an independent voter, you can vote in the independent primary and the Democrat Party primary. Can you vote in? Somebody have a question? Taylor didn't. Can an independent vote in the Republican primary? It's a question. No, they cannot. Only in the general elections. So if you're an independent, you either vote independent or Democrat in the primaries. But when it comes to the general election, you can vote there. Well, Matthew, not everybody knows that. So we'll be surprised there. Okay, moving right along. So this thing called the Electoral College, we have a little bit of an issue with. And does anybody know why we have an issue with it? You can read the slide. Does anybody have, anybody have an answer for that? You can unmute yourself. Yeah, Malin has a good point. Doesn't always represent the will of people. So probably before most of you were born, Bush v. Gore back in 2000 was one of these events. And then hopefully you were all born by 2016, Clinton v. Trump there. Where Bush had the winning, actually won delegates, but Gore had the popular vote. And in 2016, Clinton had a larger popular vote and Trump had more of an electoral vote. So what this does is it pushes these candidates in the general election to only look at states where they get the most electoral college votes. And then they forget things. They forget states like, you can look at this map, any state where there are not campaign offices, they kind of just forget them. I know in 2016, Trump came to Oklahoma twice, I think it was. That is nothing compared to how much they went to Ohio or Iowa or Colorado or Florida. They were there all the time. And so this Electoral College kind of pushes candidates to go to certain states and forget others. So that's one reason you will have to go to one of those states if you ever want to meet a candidate. But and it also brings media attention to those states. We know that up there, Vermont, New Hampshire, those kind of early states are the predictors, you could say, of media coverage of the candidates, pushing certain candidates out and all that kind of stuff. So this goes back to our lesson that we learned a couple weeks ago, that the big sort is a real thing and that the Electoral College is pushing that big sort. Moving on. Whoops, wrong button. The next national election is in 2024, but we have congressional elections on the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November every even numbered year. So do we have one in 2021? No, we don't. We have one in 2022. So those are congressional elections. That's the House of Representatives and the Senate. How long does a member of the House of Representatives serve in office? My students will know this from...
2 years.
2 years, there we go. I can't see the chat. So yeah, 2 years. And then the senator, how long do they serve?
6 years.
6 years, bingo. Well, she will get 100 on those questions on the test. Certain things you need to watch out for right there, understanding terms. Now, do congressional members have term limits? No, they don't. If any of you are from northeastern Oklahoma, you'll know Senator Inhofe has been in there longer than, I don't know, like, who knows? He'd been in there a long time. I think like 50, 60 years between the House, the Senate, and working in Washington, D.C. We call that an insider, but different day, different story.
And he got to go.
He continually gets reelected. So 6 year terms. Senator Lankford will be up for election coming up and is already drawing an opponent from Tulsa, some pastor, kind of radical Republican. Anyways, one thing important also to remember, midterm congressional elections, which will be happening 2022, which is between 2020 and 2024, you have these midterm elections. There's less media attention, there's lower voter turnout, and it's ideologically skewed, so it's more polarized, you could say. And here's the kicker within all this. The president's party almost always loses seats. So this year, who's going to lose seats, probably?
Democrats.
Democrats.
Democrats, yes. Yeah. So they will probably lose seats in the House and the Senate. So it'll be something interesting to know, because right now the Democrats...
That means they'll probably lose the majority in both, right?
It probably could be that they'll lose the majority in both. And what is that doing? That's pushing Biden to kind of steamroll, as you could say. Now, there needs to be bipartisan support on certain things for cloture rules, but it's pushing policy and regulation and laws through Congress, trying to get these things voted on before they could possibly lose their majority. Because if you're in the minority, you can't get things done without bipartisan support. So, important to know about midterm elections. President's party almost always loses seats. Moving right along, campaign structure. Now, just to let you know, I looked at this an hour before class. So, here we go. Campaigns are highly structured in a sense. They're structured like businesses. So, you have the main kind of CEO, which is your candidate. You're pushing for them, but they're treated like a sport. And the object is to win. The entire goal of people who are in office is to win election and win re-election. Major goal. If you want to talk about PhD stuff, I'm in Congress class here in a minute. Mayhew continually says the goal is to get re-elected here. Most people are not paid in elections. And who do they use mostly in campaigns to do this volunteer work? You all. You are free workers. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't go work for campaigns. They do great things. I've worked on several campaigns, but you are free labor to them. So always remember that these campaigns use a lot of volunteers and very few paid staff members because they need a high ROI. So my business folks in the classroom know that a return on investment is one of the greatest things you can get. So a dollar, you want a high ROI on that. So If you can have more volunteers pushing that and making that dollar bigger, then the campaign can go farther. Here's kind of a little chart about the campaign. Some of this stuff is contracted out, like media consultant, polling vendor, all these vendors. Those are kind of third parties. The legal team, sometimes there is a legal team on the campaign, and sometimes there's not. But the orange, reddish kind of stuff, there's the campaign manager, a communications director, and a finance, because you better keep your ducks in a row with finance, or you're going to have problems with ethics. But my communications Gaylord college students in the room, this is a great area to make a lot of money. If you saw the social media lecture that I did, whenever, I can't remember, we talked to somebody from Bully Pulpit Interactive, and they do a lot of this communication stuff, because we've seen a big rise in communications staffing in campaigns, because everything is communications with the candidate. You have to be out there. It's not so much town halls anymore. It's town halls on social media. So, any questions so far? I know I'm flying through. Maybe anything on the chat? Do lobbyists fund campaigns? We're going to talk about super PACs here in a little bit. Matt, and James, what was your question? Is there a reason for that?
I was talking about the losing seats during midterm congressional elections. I was just wondering if there's a particular reason that people notice for that.
I don't know. To an extent, I kind of believe it's complacency. You know, the Democrats won. Now they have control. And they're kind of like, okay, things are good. And if it's not front of mind, do you think about it? In that kind of sense. So that's what I'll say.
When are you going to have us do attendance?
At the end, not to worry. I'll get there. Okay, moving right along. What's this slide about? Strategy. Who is most likely to be persuaded to change their vote? Usually these are people kind of in the middle, the moderates, you could say, the kind of people who swing back and forth. And that's the reason some of these states, like Ohio and Iowa and all these others, and Florida, they swing back and forth. What were some of the states in the last election that were big on the minds of campaigns to persuade people to get out and change their minds?
California, Florida, Arizona. Texas.
Now there's some new ones.
Georgia,
Arizona, Nevada, Pennsylvania. Nevada. What was the one that really, really was different than it hadn't been a long time?
Georgia.
Georgia.
Yeah, Georgia. Georgia on my mind, right? Good song. Good song. I don't know where I was going with that. But anyways, these kind of battleground states are where kind of the margins are slim and you want to change people's vote to get reelected or get elected. Kind of television advertising. I don't know why that's there, but television advertising is important. You know, during the 5-6 o'clock news, you really want to hit there. That's when the most costly airtime is. You know, 30-second ads can cost anywhere from simple hundreds of dollars to thousands of dollars per second. Very expensive advertisements. You know, the Super Bowl is some of the most expensive, but politically, during these times, the days leading up to elections get very expensive. Moving right along, get out the vote. These are direct contact campaigns, typically focus on the base rather than mobilizing new voters. These are important. I know in Edmond, we're about to have an election come up April 6th. And these people really want to go after their base. So one of the big areas, I know I was talking to one of the candidates and she was showing me her list of everybody in town who's registered to vote, has their address, their political affiliation, if they voted in the last three elections. I think that's about it. Oh, gender. And she is going after people who are Republicans, even though municipal elections are nonpartisan. She's going after Republicans who have voted in the last three elections and are dominantly female. She's a female, obviously. And that's, she's going after her base. She knows that's her base. And instead of trying to fight over Democrats who will not vote for her or people on the Liberty ticket, she's going after these people who are kind of tried true to her base. Usually old people. Old people vote in elections. Very important to remember. Let's see. Voting is skewed by income, education, age. We know higher income, higher education often vote more liberal in this sense. And then age, work status, kind of more conservative tendencies in their religion. That plays a lot into the conservative minds. Youth voters don't participate as much, so they just ignore you. Every one of you, they just ignore you. Not to an extent, complete extent, but they just don't worry. So data analytics, how does a campaign decide who it should target? Big data is the big key here. Big data, big key for data analytics on a campaign. Remember that. Most voter information is public, like I was talking about the lady in Edmond. She goes to the Oklahoma State Election Board, and they freely give the information to her. Now, sometimes campaign groups already have this information, but that's kind of a basic way. So like the Enid City Council, I bet they're doing that kind of stuff. But when it comes to national elections, there's a lot more involved because they got the money and all that kind of stuff. Credit card and web browsing information, very important. You can purchase it. They can find your health information. They can find anything. If you're living under a rock, they can still find you. But these campaigns will go after these things because your credit card purchases and your web browsing kind of dictate your personality. So if you're shopping at, Tractor Supply, well, that's the first thing I thought of. I don't shop there. But if you're shopping there, a more farm and ranch store, these campaigns may see a dot on the data analytics to show that you're more of a conservative. Noah agrees it's a great store. We used to get chicks from there back in the day. Chickens, excuse me. All that kind of stuff. So this stuff is very important. Data is the key to trying to get to voters, because campaigns believe that they can cheaply figure out how to influence you. That's the goal, influencing. So data is used to construct complex statistical models that are meant to predict several things. Who will you vote for, whether or not you will vote, and your position on certain key issues. So they can use this to target advertisements and all that kind of stuff to you. Oops, wrong button. Something on the chat. There we go. Anyways, campaign finance rules. Donations donated directly from others to candidates are limited. I believe here in Oklahoma, it's about $2,700. And you're like, $2,700? That's like 27, no, that's like 5,400 packages of ramen noodles or whatever it is. I don't know, whatever it equates to. But $2,700 in the scheme of a national campaign is pennies. And we'll kind of look at that here in a little bit, some new data. But a municipal election, it can make a bigger difference in there. So self-funding is unlimited. This put Trump ahead in 2016 because he had a lot of money and was loaning himself money to the campaign, and the campaign had to pay him back, so probably with interest too. Not quite sure on that. So Trump put in $66 million to get presidency. John Cornes $62 million to get his Senate seat. I don't know if he got that. Forbes Kerry Romney spent around $20 million, and Linda McCannon $100 million, still no congressional seat for herself. She's been in multiple elections and has still failed. Could you imagine spending $100 million of your own money and losing every time? Big thing, like, pay attention right here. This is like, oh, a test question. So Citizens United versus FEC 2010. It's 5-4 decision by the US Supreme Court. And what it allowed was political spending is protected under the First Amendment as a right. So who got this right under that court case? That was corporations and unions, the two big groups who got First Amendment privileges under this. So corporations are now people. So if you love shopping at Target, you know, you're kind of a dollar bin kind of person. Target is now a person. So you can now say, I'm just going to see my friend Target. It's great stuff. But they can spend unlimited amounts of money on campaigning for or against candidates, however much they want, millions, billions, whatever. There are no limits there. So what this led to was the creation of super PACs to raise and spend money on the behalf of candidates. So things you need to know, Supreme Court led the creation of super PACs on spend money on candidates, and it's for corporations and unions. Any questions on that before I forget? Sorry. Nope. Yeah, great. Something you should remember. Total cost of elections. I thought this was cool. I just changed it. Melody had an older one. This is 1998 to 2020. You can see that the latest presidential race in gold was roughly $13, $14 billion. And all congressional races were about $8 billion. You can go to opensecrets.com to find that kind of stuff. And it's adjusted for inflation. So if you're an economics major, we should be friends. Cindy, those are cost of elections. Super PACs. Okay, here we go. I just updated this. Whoops, that stuff's in my way. We looked at the 2020 financial activity for super PACs. There were 2,276 super PACs in the United States, and they raised $3.4 billion. And what's interesting is they only spent $2.1 billion. So there's roughly $1.3 billion still being held by super PACs out there. And you can look at 2016, how much that changed. There was 1,207 super PACs there. And the money increase, that was $303 million versus $3 billion. And kind of an interesting thing, this little pie chart that I expanded down here kind of looks at who has the most super PACs. Conservatives spent $1.1 billion. And more liberal ones spent $902 million. And when I say liberal conservative, I don't mean Republican Democrat. Remember that. They're two different things. There's big D Democrat, which is the Democratic Party, and then there's lowercase Democrat, which is kind of just a Democratic person in that sense. Same for liberal and conservative. Liberal is somebody who's more progressive thinking, and conservative is somebody who's more traditional thinking. Very important in super PACs. Remember that stuff. Okay, I'm going to stop this. Sorry, that was the mayor of Edmond. Leave me alone. let me pull up Stephen Colbert, and we will watch that. And I will call the mayor back later. Okay, you should be able to see this.
I have a super PAC, Colbert Super PAC.
Yeah.
As far as I can tell, the difference between a PAC and a super PAC is a cover letter, because I formed a PAC. But a PAC can only take so much money, and it can only spend so much money. And I wanted to spend unlimited amounts of money and receive, more importantly, unlimited amounts of money. And so my lawyer told me all I had to do was add a cover letter that said, I intend this to be a super PAC. And it was a super PAC. And it all happened by accident. I just said, you know, maybe we'll, let's get the URL, ColbertPAC.com, just for fun, for my show. And the network called and said, you just bought a political action committee website. Are you really going to get a political action committee? And I said, why do you ask? Mm-hmm. And they said, because if you do, that could be trouble. And I said, well, then I'm going to do that. Yeah. You, Ted Koppel. Why doesn't Ted Koppel have a super PAC? It is legal for you to have a super PAC and talk about it on the air, and the FEC won't do anything about it.
And I could get lots of contributions.
You could. And you could finally have a voice in America. Don't you want your voice to be heard?
I feel like such a fool.
What the most amazing thing is I found out is that there's almost nothing that's against the law when it comes to spending political money. They're incredibly expensive. Okay. Colbert Super PAC paid for these babies. There's nothing in federal election law that says I couldn't use all the money to buy myself a sailboat.
Is that true?
That's true. If it's not illegal, you can use Super PAC money to buy it. My cause could be to educate people of how big of a boat I have. Mm-hmm. And I wish that were a joke.
But you couldn't keep it for private use, could you?
I could, yeah, sure.
Really?
I could do what Newt Gingrich has been living on. He's been living on his PAC money. And Sarah Palin. Sarah PAC, you know, the little vacation she took with her family last year where she said Paul Revere, you know, went around shooting his gun. Mm-hmm. That was all paid for by Super PAC money.
How much money have you collected so far?
Oh, the fun thing about that is I don't have to tell you.
Well, you have to tell me who sends it to you.
No, not for a while.
Well, eventually.
Eventually I do. But until then, my major donor is none of your damn business.
But every three months.
It's every 3 months once you start reporting. But I actually formed this back in July and I still haven't reported yet.
And what can happen to you?
What? I could go to FEC jail.
But they don't send people to jail.
Well, then I guess nothing will happen to me.
Well, they can fine you.
They can find me, but they have to actually rule that I did something wrong. And the FEC is a 3-3 organization, and they're far more likely to come to a tie, in which case they say, we don't know whether you've done anything wrong, in which case I can keep doing what I want.
You cannot be a candidate and run a super PAC. That would be coordinating with yourself.
And that's the problem, folks. Presidential candidates cannot coordinate with super PACs.
Mr. Speaker, are you giving any direction or advice to winning our future?
No.
Are you affiliated with them at all?
I'm not affiliated with them at all. I don't talk with them at all.
There's a bright division between what I do and what any super PAC can do. Super PACs have to be entirely separate from a campaign and a candidate. I'm not allowed to communicate with a super PAC in any way, shape, or form.
Super PACs are often run by people close to the candidate. The pro-Romney Super PAC Restore Our Future was founded by Romney's lawyer. Winning Our Future, the Newt Gingrich Super PAC, is run by a former Newt staffer. And the Rick Perry Super PAC, Make Us Great Again, was started by Mike Toomey, who was Perry's chief of staff and co-owns an island with Dave Carney, Perry's chief strategist. And I briefly kind of ran for president in South Carolina in January. Yeah. So I gave it to this guy who I barely knew, named John Stewart. Trevor, is being business partners a problem?
Being business partners does not count as coordination legally.
Great. All right. All right, John, prepare yourself.
Here we go.
Trevor, if you will, Colbert Super PAC transfer activate.
Colbert Super PAC is dead.
But it has been reborn.
The definitely not coordinating with Stephen Colbert Super PAC!
Now that I have the Super PAC, can I run ads supporting Stephen Colbert, who I believe in very deeply, and perhaps attacking his potential opponents, who I don't believe in at all?
Yes, you can, as long as you do not coordinate.
Can I legally hire Stephen's current Super PAC staff to produce these ads that will be in no way coordinated with Stephen?
Yes.
What will become of the money?
Who's asking? We're Americans for better tomorrow. Right. And starting first thing tomorrow, we're going to figure out how to make the world a better place tomorrow. In the meantime, we're just collecting money.
I see.
It's funny until you think about it. The fact of the matter is Stephen Colbert has proved by going before the Federal Election Commission, by becoming a super PAC, by now handing the super PAC over to his buddy John Stewart so that he can go and run to be president of South Carolina, he is proving how ridiculous this system has become.
Perfect. Exciting stuff there. Well, I'm teaching today. sorry, in Congress, getting ready for that. Anyways, you think of that kind of as a funny example, but it's actually, I mean, it was all legal in that sense. So very important things. Remember all about Citizens United there. And we're going to talk about the role of image quickly. One of the things was when this started was with JFK and Nixon, one of the first presidential debates that aired on television. Nixon did not wear stage makeup in this sense, and which anybody on television is usually wearing some level of makeup, and JFK did. Nixon looked very sweaty, tired, clammy, and all that kind of stuff, and JFK looked good. And it actually proved to be kind of a boost for Kennedy at that time. Yes, Jackson, it was a very entertaining time. So advertising always appeals to different people, different emotions. You have different campaign ads that target fear, that target happiness, that target kind of love, and all that kind of stuff. So some things you want to think about: which of these following campaign ads are best for you, why, and what emotions do they bring out? Because this Friday, or if you're one of my students, you're doing a campaign advertisement, and you'll be presenting those in class. So the first one we're going to do is doing a lot of screen sharing today. You should be able to see Daisy Girl right now, right? Great. Here we go. It's a great advertisement.
One, two, three, four, five, seven, six, eight, Nine, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
These are the stakes: to make a world in which all of God's children can live, or to go into the dark. We must either love each other, or we must die.
Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
Well, that was invigorating right there. Sorry, poor Daisy. She died. Yeah, David, that was a lot. Okay, moving right along. Ronald Reagan, one of the memorable things.
There's a bear in the woods. For some people, the bear is easy to see. Others don't see it at all. Some people say the bear is tame. Others say it's vicious and dangerous. Since no one can really be sure who's right, isn't it smart to be as strong as the bear? If there is a bear.
Ooh. So kind of that fear tactic there, going against his adversary there in that election. We're going to talk about Willie Horton. Here's an attack ad.
Bush and Dukakis on crime. Bush supports the death penalty for first-degree murderers. Dukakis not only opposes the death penalty, he allowed first-degree murderers to have weekend passes from prison. One was Willie Horton, who murdered a boy in a robbery, stabbing him 19 times. Despite a life sentence, Horton received 10 weekend passes from prison. Horton fled, kidnapped a young couple, stabbing the man and repeatedly raping his girlfriend. Weekend prison passes. Dukakis on crime.
Yeah, so Bush there was kind of, Bush, the Republican, H.W. Bush, was going after Dukakis for his kind of non-ability to be tough on crime. And we're looking about Gerald Darty. Please re-elect Gerald.
We've got room to put 2,700 people in our jail, and it costs us about $103 a day.
Gerald really doesn't have any hobbies.
Last year's tax rate was 0.4169. This year, we could take that down to 3,838.
So is he always like that?
Yeah, all the time.
which means that the 3838 is probably going to go somewhere between 3838 and 41.69.
Most people leave their work at the office.
We got three light rail cars. You can put 60 people on each car. So even if you add two cars, you're talking about maybe 300 people that are affected. There are a million people in this community. I mean, that is 0.01 to the 8th power if you round it off at zero.
All he wants to do is fix things.
So I got this 18-wheeler that's parked in this neighborhood, viewing fumes all over the place, but quite frankly, it's not a code violation. You know, I think I like helping around the house here.
Please reelect Gerald. Please.
She wants him out. But yeah, kind of going on that kind of stuff there. And then one of my favorite, this will not be on the poll, but this is the dumpster fire one.
Some people see a dumpster fire and do nothing but watch the spectacle.
This is my educational career right here.
Some are too scared to face the danger, or they think it will benefit them if they just let it keep on burning. Others shrug and say, oh, all this talk of a dumpster fire, it's just fake news. There is an inferno raging in Washington. But here in the land of 10,000 lakes, we know how to put out a fire.
I am Richard Painter, and I approve of this message.
Dumpster fires. Great stuff right there. Okay, we're going to start a poll real quick. Pull out your phones. Which one was your favorite advertisement? 2 minutes on that kind of stuff right there. Poll is live. Thank you, Samuel. Feel the love there. Okay, where were we going? Let me pull something up. So yeah, we got about 20 participants. Keep moving on that. Let me share my screen again. We will do attendance at the end. So how negative should you go? Pretty negative is the goal in a lot of these things. Negative ads usually have more of an effect on people and all that kind of stuff. And the Republican groups usually, as you can see throughout time, have been the ones to do more negative ads. Now, they're all pretty much above 50%. I mean, the Democratic groups in 2012, this is pretty outdated, but that's fine. Democratic groups, 78% of the time went negative. And then Republican groups, 89% of the time went negative. So negativity is how things go and all that kind of stuff. Oh, yes, the poll is a different ad from Ronald Reagan. I didn't see that. We will have to watch Morning Again in America if you haven't seen it. It's a good one. So moving right along, we don't have much time left, so we got to get through four more slides and some discussions. Going digital is one of the biggest things. You can see on this one, I believe this was in my media lecture, I can't remember. I did it. U.S. total advertising that's going digital is at, what is that, $3.2 billion. So that's a lot of money going to digital campaign advertisements there. So that's Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, all that kind of stuff. And then a funny tweet by Hillary Clinton to Donald, delete your account. I don't know why that's funny. Anyways, moving on, favorite advertisement was Gerald Ford. Please reelect Gerald. Then a lot of people put Morning Again America. And LBJ Daisy was third. Surprised people didn't like that one. So one of the things with advertising and all that and social media is it's wearing people out. And they kind of just disengage from politics on these things. And they think of it as stressful. That's probably why a lot of these cause maybe some more mental health issues around election time. You start fighting with family. And all that kind of stuff. So we know that these advertisements are just making things stressful and frustrating, and a lot of them are really not informational and all that kind of stuff. Filters, the many users feel that social media encourages people to say things about politics they would never say in person. I always tell people on who want to argue with me on social media, I'll sit down for you and have coffee. I've never had anybody really take me up on that. They usually just want to stand behind their little keyboard and put things out. Very interesting on there. And only listen to people who agree with you. So the campaigns are going after these people because they want an echo chamber within their campaign. So one area I want to look at, and you can do this too, we're done with these advertisements here, is your account data on Instagram and Facebook. Facebook and Instagram and TikTok and all these are always pulling information in about you. So one thing they like about me, physical fitness, footwear, real estate, yoga, I don't do yoga, whatever, tourism, food, I know there was wine, running, DIY kind of stuff, and they will tailor advertisements on this to me. The Facebook, Donald Trump, Barack Obama, Bernie Sanders, they're looking at things that kind of relate to me or things maybe I spent more time looking at. I know at Facebook, usually if you spend about 1.5 seconds looking at something or pausing on there, it will show an interest to you. 3 seconds is a complete view on something. So yeah, you can go all through there and it'll tell you everything about you and your interest on there. So it's actually pretty interesting stuff. You can go through there and look at things you like and all that kind of stuff. Instagram, I don't know how to do it on TikTok because I'm not cool enough for TikTok yet, but oh well. Somebody's asking about attendance. Do I have any questions today on the lecture? Before I forget. Yeah, Lululemon was on there because my friend, she's in the MBA at ORU, and she was asking me about Lululemon. And apparently they have men's running shorts. Did not know that. Learned something new. So now you know. We're going to take attendance real quick. And attendance is live. And once you do attendance, you can go. No, they're not the best shorts. They need.
Say, Eric, just to make sure, this Friday, our videos are due?
Correct. Videos are due this Friday in my lecture, my class, everybody.
You've given us 2 weeks.
No.
Okay.
You're fine.
That's not. Okay. Have a good day, Eric.
Yep, you too.
Party. Yeah, we're good okay. to go.
This is kind of nice without having to yell back sooner for once.
Oh, sorry. And we got done 3 minutes early. Couldn't
have. No complaints.
Yeah, Isabel's got sooner on there. Jacob.
Boo. All right, later.
Cindy, see you later.
Bye, sir.
Yep, have a good day.
You too. Good luck.
You can do part of the video in class, Max. Yeah, we know Jackson's not fit for the job, John Henry.
I actually have a question.
Yeah, go ahead, Chad.
So in Cengage, the part 2 writing activities, are those like, I see that they're graded. When are they due?
I don't think those are actually like points graded. Don't worry about the like writing portions. You only have to do those wrap it up quizzes.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else have any questions?